brought to you by Penguin.
Uncertain. How to turn your biggest fear into your greatest power. By Arie Kruglanski. Read by Esh Alladi. Introduction. Escaping and embracing uncertainty. It so happened that as I set out to write this book about uncertainty, people worldwide were experiencing it in massive doses during the COVID-19 pandemic. Just about everyone's plans and routines had been turned topsy-turvy. To be clear, I didn't decide to address uncertainty because of the pandemic. In fact, I had committed to this book way before it happened. Life was humming along with its mundane worries, joys, and challenges. The pandemic changed all that dramatically. By the time I started writing, uncertainty was a defining part of everyone's everyday experience. Living in its shadow whilst also contemplating its nature allowed me to see aspects of uncertainty I had never before considered. This new reality somehow broke my mindset about uncertainty. It challenged the common perspective about it to which I too had formerly subscribed. The new insights I garnered were a personal silver lining to what was otherwise a trying and constraining time. This book distills then what I have learned about uncertainty, not only over the last few years, but over a lifetime of research and study. For as much as my views have developed, my interest in uncertainty has been a constant. From the early 1980s through to my present-day role as director of the Motivated Cognition Laboratory at the University of Maryland, it has been a subject of personal and professional fascination. The pioneering work on the human need for closure I conducted with Tali Freund, Donna Webster, and Adina Clem in the 1980s and 1990s brought uncertainty into the mainstream of psychological study. Since then, we've carried out hundreds of studies the world over to explore this fundamental aspect of the shared human predicament, our relationship with uncertainty. And the scale we developed to measure people's desire for certainty and closure has been translated into 20 different languages that I know of, and is used across Europe and in the Americas, Asia, the Middle East, and Africa. Why this fascination? For two reasons, really. Uncertainty affects almost everything we do, and our reactions to uncertainty have a wide-ranging impact on broad social phenomena from love to politics and beyond. In this book, I'll share with you everything that I've learned in the hope that you may gain a better understanding not just of the uncertainty that characterizes our lives, but also your own personal relationship with it. As you learn, each of us is different in the way we respond to uncertainty. But we all have the capacity to harness the remarkable gifts that uncertainty can offer and face down the worst fears it brings. The myth of the dark unknown. To most people, uncertainty carries exclusively negative connotations, and the idea that people desire certainty seems an obvious truth. This belief is so commonplace among both laypeople and scientists that we rarely, if ever, pause to question it. Indeed, it's a trope lying at the very bedrock of our culture. We find it in the sage advice of the fictional figure Albus Dumbledore, headmaster of Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry, who declaimed that it is the unknown we fear when we look upon death and darkness, nothing more. And in psychologist N.R. Carlton's assertion that fear of the unknown may be a, or possibly is the, fundamental fear, as well as in art and literature. We fear that which we cannot see, remarked Tita Kubo, a Japanese manga artist, while author H.P. Lovecraft wrote that the oldest and strongest kind of fear is fear of the unknown. The widespread anxiety experienced by people during the COVID-19 pandemic seems to support the view that uncertainty is frightening and threatening. As Kathleen Parker, a Washington Post columnist, noted on 13th of November 2020, drinking is on the rise and smoking is making a comeback. Google searches for anxiety in the past week reached a 16-year high. When COVID started to take hold, millions of people around the globe began experiencing severe angst about the unprecedented situation they found themselves in. Data from across the world attested to a significant spike in reported distress tied to the pandemic, with the World Health Organization, the WHO, reporting a 35% increase in the prevalence of distress in China, 60% in Iran, and 45% in the US. In the Amhara region of Ethiopia, a threefold increase in the frequency of depression and anxiety relative to the pre-pandemic rate was recorded. At the time of writing, figures from all corners of the world indicated the same thing. Wherever you look, people are deeply troubled and disconcerted. Causality or correlation? Yet the global rise in both uncertainty and distress does not prove that the former necessarily caused the latter. Scientists never tire of explaining that correlation does not mean causation. Just because two things happen simultaneously or closely together in time does not mean that one is the cause of the other. For instance, it has been found that in major US cities, the greater amount of ice cream sold, the more murders are committed. Does that mean that eating ice cream makes you more likely to commit murder, or that committing murder whets the appetite for ice cream? Both possibilities appear ludicrous, and they are. Instead, the summer heat, a third factor, could both whet an appetite for ice cream and be a source of frustration that incites aggression. Or consider the finding that the number of churches in a city is linked to the amount of crime. One could speculate that Catholic churches help absolve us of guilt, and so disinhibit our indulgences, which makes crime possible. Or perhaps crime induces guilt, hence the greater need for churches that offer a way to absolution. Both explanations seem far-fetched. Indeed, there is a much simpler explanation which relates to a city's size. The larger the city's population, the greater the number of churches, and also, unrelatedly, the opportunity for crime. So the fact that people experienced angst and uncertainty during the pandemic doesn't mean that the two are causally related. The pandemic generated both uncertainty and angst, but the angst does not come from the uncertainty as such. It comes from fear of negative outcomes, the bad things that could happen because of the pandemic. Trivial, irrelevant uncertainties don't evoke distress at all. Uncertainty about the weather produces a barely noticeable change in our emotions, and so does uncertainty about the outcome of an athletic competition between teams we don't care about or political elections in a faraway land. Even when uncertainty is about things that do matter, any angst evoked is not caused by the uncertainty itself, but by the bad news that may be linked to that uncertainty, whether it's the increased likelihood of severe illness, death, the loss of loved ones or a job, restrictions to our freedom, and so on. Pause for a moment and ask yourself, would you rather have a 90% chance of contracting the virus or a 50% chance? Most people would opt for the 50% chance, even though, as with the toss of a coin, the outcome here is completely uncertain. The 90% chance, while much more certain, is intuitively much less preferable and much more anxiety-provoking. So it is not the uncertainty as such that is troubling, but the adverse consequences that the pandemic makes more likely. Uncertainty, objective and subjective. Uncertainty is the rule rather than the exception when it comes to our lives. There is simply no way of knowing what comes next. Prediction is tough, especially of the future, quipped Yogi Berra, an American baseball player known for his pithy and paradoxical statements. Perhaps the reason why prediction is so precarious is that what has come before can never be repeated and can never, in itself, fully determine what will happen in the future. The 6th century BC Greek philosopher Heraclitus highlighted this sense of flux, pointing out that no man ever steps in the same river twice, for it's not the same river, and he's not the same man. Far more recently, the 20th century philosopher Karl Popper discussed at length what is known as the fallacy of induction. No matter how many white swans you may have seen so far, the generalization that all swans are white, or indeed any other generalization made from experience, is unwarranted, because the very next swan you may encounter could be black. Benjamin Franklin famously remarked that in this world, nothing can be said to be certain except death and taxes. Yet we might wonder about these two as well. Who knows? In short, human lives are suffused with uncertainty, and any certainty we experience can be banished by unexpected events. Take the striking story of Travis Roy, a gifted college hockey player who in the 11th minute of his first game from Boston University, BU, crashed into the boards at high speed and snapped his fourth and fifth cervical vertebrae.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.